Hello, folks, and welcome to the Friend or Foe Esports League Friend or Foe Series. I am your friendly neighborhood shoutcaster, Sharagan, and I have joining with me today, Anti. How's it going, man?
Hello. I'm doing quite well myself. That was an immediate thresh ban. Like, the draft barely started. Instant. Gone. Meanwhile, BBZ are taking their time. It was like, okay, we'll get rid of the Wukong.
Thank you.
Now it's just... It's like going back and forth, slowly but surely.
I feel like both of these teams have a pretty good idea of who's going to be, who wants to play what, and so it feels like they've definitely dialed each other in. It looks like we're going for the straight top bans, keeping Orphic from becoming the Orphic diff that loses BBZ the game, and getting rid of Songo's Thresh, which honestly, we've only seen him play it a couple of times, but he's definitely really solid on it, and he's got a Thresh by the nature of the champion, has so much utility that he's just kind of one of those you really got to decide, do you want him on your team or do you want to just avoid him?
And interestingly here, so the takeaway from lights from the Sylas, definitely strong. The Irelia ban, very strange to see an Irelia ban in the first rotation, especially because I don't think Irelia is honestly very strong in a 5v5 scenario. So unless they're picking something like Quinn top or something that gets absolutely shafted by Irelia, I'm kind of surprised to see in first rotation of bans. I would have expected to see that in the second wave.
I'm trying to remember if we've seen lights on Irelia, because Irelia is one of those flex picks. You can take top or mid lane, and I think Irelia mid is definitely one of the useful champions to have available if you want to have an AD mid laner. And we have the immediate lock-in of the Morgana and Ujir bans, probably both junglers getting picked right now. We've been seeing a lot of Morgana jungle. It brings a lot of utility. And if you're able to...
And the Blind Varus.
I'm not 100% sold on a Blind Varus because that's a really risky choice. However...
Yeah, I think Varus is a very strong counter-pick champion. I'm not too certain about the Blind pick. I mean, we could see it flex to mid. Who knows?
We could see it flex to mid because... AP Varus can become an absolute monster. I was watching a couple of clips. I know that I've mentioned this before. You see it, he built like a Liandry's and a couple of other items. I can't remember off the top of my head. Unshotted in Ornn.
Yeah, it was Ludens Echo.
Ludens, sorry, not Liandry's, Ludens. But still, one shot in Ornn. You know exactly what clip I'm talking about. Shoots out the ult, gets the three stacks of corruption, one fully charged arrow, and he's just gone.
It's something else. So we see the Vel'Koz and the Tristana pickup. Now, Vel'Koz as a support can work, but with so many strong engaged supports in the meta right now, I doubt that we're going to see that Vel'Koz in support, or else it's going to be punished very hard. So I'm thinking that that's going to be a Vel'Koz mid. Tristana pickup is usually good blind because you can flex it to mid if necessary, but BBZ have already shown their Varus pick, so just picking up the Tristana, totally acceptable here.
Yeah, and it looks like BBZ is not expecting the Vel'Koz support at all with the Rakan ban. I have a feeling that we've got our bot lane and jungler showing on the side of BBZ, and Spear has got their mid laner showing. So we're basically looking at this point at the top picks coming out from Spear. I'm expecting Orphic to go something kind of hard and heavy. I was going to say Renekton, but obviously they just banned out Renekton. He doesn't have his... set available, but the Ornn is still on the table and was not banned out. So that might be something we'll be seeing. Alistar is most likely going to be going against someone who gets picked here shortly. I'm still thinking it's a Morgana jungle. Go ahead.
It's just that the two support bans from BBZ here are a little bit atypical. Rakan and Braum, not bad champions by any means. Some things that we see a little bit less, and Akali pickup for BBZ, which, you know, we know Lice can do some stuff on that champion.
Exactly. Yeah, that's most likely a mid Akali, so that's kind of, and into a Vel'Koz, I think that's probably a really strong pickup. You've got a lot of mobility with her shurikens in order to dodge the Vel'Koz CC and get back in if you manage to hit, so that's going to be really useful. We've got the Cho'Gath coming out. We have seen Orphic on Cho'Gath, and that he became an absolute monster. That is a late-game scaling champion that can be super scary for squishies.
Now, because of that, we could end up seeing Varus pivot into the on-hit variant. A lot of Spear's champions aren't necessarily super long-range for the Varus to like be that afraid of, that he has to go for the lethality build. But importantly here, there's nobody who can really match the side lane pressure of the Akali right now. So if BBZ pick another strong side laner, and they just go for a 1-3-1 split comp, I'm not too sure what Spear's going to be able to do.
I have a feeling they're going to be going for that. We have the game with the gameplay lock, and we have that 1-3-1 split comp. That is going to be really hard for Spear to face up against, but they do have a lot of advanced CC advantage with at Skarner. With the Skarner pickup, that's going to allow them to, if they manage to get a pickoff on the side, completely eliminate a threat by pulling the Varus out of that back line, pulling him into range of Cho'Gath, pulling him into range of the Vel'Koz. Stuff like that's going to be really devastating for BBZ. They're going to have to watch out for it. But I agree with you completely, Anti, that the way this game is built right now, my money's on BBZ.
Like, it's something that where they have to get ahead, but if they get ahead, which we all know just how strong BBZ is when it comes to getting ahead, they can absolutely demolish this game.
They definitely could. We're going to have to keep an eye on that mid laner and what this Orianna is, or what this Morgana is doing, because switching the Morgana over to the support lane is going to probably shut down this Alistar. But I think we're ready to hop onto the Rift and actually take a look at how things will play out.
Yeah, and surprisingly enough, the early Morgana pick actually ended up did getting Flex into support. And Spear, we know that they love their Skarner. But it's not that easy for Skarner to do too much in this game, because Akali can just shroud away, so Skarner can't use the point and click. Gangplank can use oranges to get out of the ulti, and Alistar even can just ulti to get out. Varus is going to be so far in the back line that Dax ends up being the only real target for Skarner, and pulling the Udyr directly into your team isn't always the best of choices.
It really isn't, and I do see that. I think that Diddle may actually be a Vel'Koz one trick. I'm not entirely 100% sure on that. But if he is, we may be seeing some interesting styling on that, because, you know, playing a champion into a champion you're not necessarily strong against, from a theorycraft standpoint, does mean that if you know the champion's ins and out, you're going to be able to play it just fine. All right. So I'm looking at the way this game's going to play out. That top lane is going to be something interesting to watch. Cho'Gath is going to be a little bit weaker early on, especially into a Gangplank. So we might be seeing Orphic set behind a little bit. Nothing real crazy on the side of summoners. It does look like the bot lanes are looking for kill pressure with those ignites. But neither side went heal. They both went exhaust, which is something to point out.
Also, crucially, Varus has lethal tempo. He is opting into the on-hit Varus. And that means that he's going to be closer up. It is going to be easier for Skarner to access the Varus. But also, there's only two teleports in this game. Neither mid laner opted for a teleport. And, well, you know, it's not necessarily something that we'll see very often. Bot lane didn't opt into teleport either.
Yeah. No, and I think it's Akali looking for that kill pressure is definitely the way you play Akali. You go for the kill pressure, or you go for the absolute crazy split pushing. I'm not really sure exactly how things are going to play out. We are seeing a little bit of bouncing back and forth between Nier and Orphic. That is probably going to be the state of that lane, constantly going back and forth, back and forth. I do think Nier is just going to have a major advantage with those barrel ranges, and though it does look like they're keeping about even.
Yeah, early game, Gangplank does quite a bit in terms of Vayne dominance. So you should be able to just continually punish Orphic for existing. The biggest thing about Cho'Gath, though, is that if you're poking Cho'Gath, you have to make sure that damage sticks. Because every time that Cho'Gath hits the minions, and like if he takes a minion, he's going to heal up, going to get the mana back. So all that poke isn't really going to mean that much.
Yeah, that is pretty true, and something that they're going to have to watch out for. I just can't wait until we get to level 4, level 5 of this mid lane and start seeing some crazy Akali juke sticks coming out. And I'm looking forward to that. This bot lane, I have a feeling, is going to be kind of a humdrum lane. They're probably going to let it push in. Varus definitely wants to get this closer to his tower. Red's going to want to just farm up safely. Pingu looking for a little bit of a spicy play right here, though.
And we know that Big Brain's down on the bot lane. They're looking to make something happen. But it's just going to be a trade of scuttles.
Right here, we have the reverse as Dax is up in the top lane, getting a nice bit of stuns off. This is a lot of damage coming out, and that could very well be first blood going over to Dax.
And really good gank there. And they're just gonna shove this in, force the TP out from Orphic, and Gangplank's gonna back, get a Sheen, and he's in a really good position for this lane.
Very good position, and it's the exact opposite of what Big Brain Brian was trying to do in the bot lane. The outcomes are completely different. Like I said, Red and Songo want that lane pushed into their tower. They timed it perfectly to where Orphic was finishing up his Brian was finishing up his build, clear, and coming down to the bot side. I just can't word today for some odd reason.
It happens. It happens.
just a little bit. All right. So it does look like we've got Drake coming up here in about 28 seconds. So that'll be the first big objective on the board. With the way these clears have come out, Dax is going to be in a perfect position to basically back, get his items, head into that, and probably just be ready to kind of cut Big Brain Brian right off the pass.
Mm-hmm. And one of the biggest things here is that now Gangplank has a lead. Gangplank needs to have a lead in this game so that way he can continually apply side lane pressure. Because, like I said, they're running a 1-3-1 split comp, and they need to make sure that their side laners can't be contested. And if they can't be contested, this game is so very heavily in BBZ's favor, but if it gets to the point where they can't side lane, Team Spear could just run them over in a 5v5.
They are certainly going to attempt for it, and that definitely looks like what they're going to be going for. Right here, Nier's going to get a nice, juicy wave right under his tower. Gangplank loves clearing under tower. That's kind of like one of his favorite spots to be. We do have, like I said, we have our Big Brain Brian coming into the bot lane. He's already spotted out, and we've got our buddy Dax hanging up right behind that tower, just ready for this engage. And let's see if we're going to have something here. Probably not.
Yeah, I don't really think they're going to be able to do too much here, because while the Morgana is a good flex pick, Morgana in lane is more about denying the enemy from doing something. But unfortunately, with the Tristana here, the Triss is just going to sit in lane, farm up, and you know, she will scale. Don't get me wrong. Like, Triss doesn't hate scaling, but it just means that this lane's not going to amount to do too much.
Not too terribly. I do like this audacity coming out from Dax right now as he goes into the bot side jungle to put down that control ward and then gank Diddle's lane. It, just getting that vision is going to be really useful because they're already going to start moving up towards this Drake. Probably get this gank off here in the mid lane, get the pushed in, get that prio, and then head down to Dragon. And that's going to be a major objective that Team Spear is not going to be able to respond to because they've got their gank going on here in the top lane. Right now, we've got Nier getting caught out, losing a lot of damage, and Big Brain Brian gets himself a kill.
Yeah, and you know, Nier wanted to really hold on to the oranges to try to make a to try to make their way out. But you know, Brian's just gonna hold on to that E until the very last moment, where there's going to be so much damage that that remove strawberry doesn't even really do anything.
Yeah, I couldn't tell, but it does look like the chomp did come out. It was a little bit early, so he wasn't able to get the execute off, which is good for Nier because that means that Cho'Gath is still behind one of his stacks. The longer you can delay those stacks, the better, because eventually he's just going to become a monster no matter what state of the game is.
Now, one of the big things here,
Songo not being in the right spot.
I don't think Orphic and Brian actually shoved in the wave, so I don't think Nier actually loses too much, because Nier still has TP and managed to get to lane in time to grab everything, so they're still chilling with a CS lead with the TP available.
They are, like, that is something really important. I feel like Nier is definitely playing for the long con, just because of the fact you've got that. He's held onto his TP. He held onto his oranges. It's more of like, he's like, you know what? I can be patient. I can go ahead and wait this out. It's fine. We'll scale into the late game. And once I get to my wave pushing potential, they'll have to send Cho'Gath to deal with me.
And one of the things that BBZ has been doing great this game is their bot lane wave management has been really on point. For the first gank with Skarner coming bot, they knew that they were going to be weak side because their jungler was pathing top, so they let the wave push in towards them. And then later on, they shove it out right as the enemy bot lane leaves, and then they transition that into a dragon. BBZ is honestly playing the map very well right now.
Their macro is on point. Like, look right now, we've already got Dax up by the Rift Herald, so they've already basically secured the two primary objectives at the beginning of this game. Oh. Despite the fact that we have a fight here in the bot lane, that is a nice lockdown on Songo. Songo's going to take a lot of damage, but he's not going to go down. That is Leshy taking a tower shot. Again, Varus is not able to get the kill off, but has put Leshy in a position that he's probably going to have to back.
Yeah, and I'm certain Songo's, like, really close to hitting level 6, so walking up there, he was like, oh, you know, I shouldn't be able to get punished too hard for this. I'll be able to ult out. But the minion's just not quite going to die to give the ulti over just yet. But they're just going to heal up with that passive and be just fine.
Exactly. Look at that. That is a nice plan by Diddle. Diddle knew exactly where he was, obviously, because he was sitting on a ward. But that was a good backstop. We do have Big Rain Brian. He was in the bot side bush. He was waiting to gank when Varus let the wave push in once again as Tristana engaged. So again, that is a second gank bot side that Brian just was not able to get in a position that he wanted. And I think that's kind of the state of this game, unfortunately, for him.
Interesting thing here. Nier is itemizing into crit gangplank. So not the bruiser gangplank that we're used to seeing more often, but instead this is going to be like an Essence Reaver, probably into like a Collector. You know, we're just going to go the full shebang when it comes to crit chance. And this gangplank is going to be doing quite a bit of damage.
Yeah, absolutely, and I think if you're going for that 1-3-1 split comp, you want to be able to push the wave as fast as you possibly can, and crit is definitely the way to go.
Songo's still not 6. Like, they're looking to make a play down here, but when Alistar's not 6, the ability to dive is massively hindered. But just going to hit 6 right there. But the opportunity is gone at this point.
It really is, unfortunately. We did have Dax heading out over there. So that's the first Dax gank that we've seen not work out perfectly. His gank mid lane right here. This is a great gank. Nice chilling smite coming down. Good stun off. We do have Akali going in, doing the dialing off. We got the gangplank ult coming down as well. Diddle is going to go down. Dax takes a couple of tower shots, and so does Lights, but not enough to actually go down. We have the TP from Orphic, though. He's looking for Chomp, but he is so hungry right now. Good flash by Brian. Gets the stun off. That's going to be Akali going down to Orphic as Orphic gets the Chomp off, and that is going to be a suppression and a pullback as Dax is taking a lot of damage, and Tristana comes to join this fight as well. This is BBZ getting collapsed on. On hit Varus. Hits the Blast Cone, trying to save his support, but doesn't quite shoot over the wall the correct direction. Barrel is down, but is not able to hit. Nier has to flash out. We do have Big Brain Brian still trying to chase down this gangplank, but his ulti has already been used. That is going to be 2 kills over for the side of Team Spirit, while nothing for the side of BBZ. We got the fight still going on in the bot lane. My bad. Cheeky Pinku is going to get a bounce. We got a bounce coming out as Tristana jumps onto Songo, going for the easy kill. Ignite is down on there. Tristana is going to get a double kill, but Morgana is going to go down. So that is 3 kills for Team Spirit and 1 kill for BBZ.
Yeah, that ends up being, you know, the Vel'Koz ended up dying. But that's Akali, Udyr, Varus, and Alistar all going down for, you know, we got, it's 2-for-4, and it's 12 minutes into the game. BBZ need the gold lead, and this might end up snowballing a spear ahead with their 5v5 comp.
That could be, BBZ is going to have to make sure that they are very careful with the next couple of fights coming up, because of the fact that they are not a team fighting comp, they are very much a split pushing comp. That was a beautifully played set of mid lane. That was really well done. They got themselves the kill on Vel'Koz. They do need to be careful about these disengages, though, and not taking fights that are unnecessary.
Now, one of the big things here is that Tristana was the one who got those kills. And because of that, she's able to afford her entire Kraken Slayer while Red is still sitting on components. And because of that, she's going to have so much kill pressure in this lane that originally, you know, because of the Alistar, she wasn't going to be able to do much in. Dax
was he was trying to bait it out just a little bit. I think he wanted to get Orphic a little bit closer so that Nier could join in this fight. They do have the Rift Herald down, so they are planning on letting it at least hit. We do see Orphic, though. He's trying to just kill it before it ever has a chance to get there, just to basically be like, hey, stop it. Get off my tower. They aren't going to be able to do it as it comes down. He does get the stun off. Dax is getting out Nier as well. We do have a fight going on the bot side, though.
Another kill.
All right, so let's see how this plays out. It looks like it was a basic engage right here. That was a good black shield on the side of Cheeky Pingu. Does get a nasty root as Leshy just jumps in from the lane, getting off the passives to get the bomb to go off. That was a little bit of a bad play by BBZ.
Yeah, like Pingu has been getting so many of these good ulties off, like to start these fights for Spear, and you know Red getting caught out there, you know, is really unfortunate. But Gatchostano with the fully completed Kraken Slayer is going to be doing so much damage that there's just not that much they can do about that in response.
For right now, absolutely. Leshy is sitting on a 300 bounty, though, so that if they are able to take Leshy down and get a good lockdown, that's going to be a lot of gold on whoever manages to take them out. Akali did opt for the Night Harvester build rather quickly. I'm not entirely certain if that was the best choice.
Night Harvester does allow her to spike early. You know, we also see things like Rocket Belt every now and then. But it is just a matter of getting in and doing the damage rather than the extended damage output that you'll get from Riftmaker.
True. Personally, I feel like Riftmaker or Hextech would have been a little bit better. That's just personal preference. Dax right now looking for a nice gank in the mid lane. He does have a lack of vision. Oh? BBZ Red getting jumped on without his support, taking a lot of damage. Going to get all... Oh, going to get taken down right there.
Trying
to keep Leshy under tower, but just is not quite able to. Did have ultimate up, but the black shield was there to prevent that from actually resulting in a kill.
Yeah, and the exhaust was like pretty late from Red, unfortunately. Like the flash, immediate. That was great. But once Rosana follows you, you know, she's going to be doing so much damage.
I feel like he didn't expect... Oh, we got a nice jump in. Pengu getting rooted, though, as he lands right on top. That is going to be a flash out as he has to avoid getting killed by the Tristana. He is ignited, though, so he's visible. So Tristana, Leshy is able to jump in and just jump right back out. Leshy is going to be the one who's going to carry this game.
Leshy has 5 kills out of 8. 15 minutes into the game. And Alexis is going to come down, try to one-shot Tristan, you know, with the Night Harvester.
I don't think so. I think Lights is just looking for a chance to get out of here.
Mm-hmm. I mean, with the Night Harvester, it's itemized fairly well into this, but Brian coming in.
Brian coming in, trying to get something off, does get rooted in place. Lights getting slowed, though. That is going to be a nice knockup as Cho'Gath has joined this fight as well. There is a lot of damage coming out, but there's not going to be a kill resulted. We do have Nier in the top lane. Orphic getting the work done. Going to be getting both top towers taken down. BBZ is starting to fall behind, and they are hitting some really bad spots.
All right, so what exactly happened here? Okay, so Herald went down.
Mm-hmm. We're going to have the Herald come down. It's going to take out the tower right here. Orphic's then going to start the chase. Nier's not going to have the movement speed to really get out. That is a lot of slows on the side of Orphic, as he's just hitting him constantly, keeping him from being able to go anywhere. And then you got the chomp. This is just Cho'Gath doing Cho'Gath things. He's gotten to that point now where he's just so tanky that they just can't get through him. Mm-hmm. Look at that damage. Dax trying to get some work up, but not quite able to. In the meantime, in the bot lane, we've got more going on. Red's going to go down once again. Leshy's just bouncing around all over the place. Orphic taking a lot of damage, though. Dax is not quite able to kill him, though. He's trying to chip away at this Cho'Gath's health. There's just so much. Lots of back and forth, but the chomp comes up. And he gets yet another stag as he just eats him alive.
Oh my god. Now, Dax was doing their best. You know, Orphic was taking so much damage. But it's right at the end there, with the chomp coming back up, Orphic just takes Dax's life in return.
Yeah, that's one of those things that it's really tough. I feel like Orphic trying to kite out the damage as much as possible... staying out, like trying to avoid as much of Orphic's damage, resulted in him probably missing one or two auto attacks, and that was what resulted in him dying right there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's just rough. Orphic has become a huge threat, as has Leshy, to where I don't know if BBZ is going to have an opportunity to come back yet.
Yeah, I mean, like right now, I don't think that BBZ's team will accurately scale into this comp. So their only real choice right now is to group up as five,
look for some picks. You have Alistar, you have Varus, you have very good pick-making champions. But, you know, we need to see BBZ make these proactive plays, but we haven't seen that from them much this season.
Correct. Yeah. No, definitely BBZ is one of those teams that once they're behind and it's really tough. Look at that root.
Oh,
that is
God.
Fantastic. Look at the black shield coming out. So much damage as Varus just gets absolutely deleted.
Leshy is putting out so much damage this game. And, you know, Pingu is doing such an amazing job at putting Leshy in a position to do all this damage.
Pingu is getting some absolutely fantastic roots down. However, Red has been mispositioning in such a way that it has been absolutely devastating. He knows that they're probably watching him kill that ward. He knows they're waiting on the other side. Morgana's Q will easily reach him.
Oh,
look at this,
God.
We got a huge fight going on right there. Nice chains of corruption coming down. We have Dax trying to run away. He's not going to be able to, as there are now three. He gets suppressed and just eaten alive by Orphic once again. That is a nice bit of chicken snacks.
Oh my God. Spear have just been running around the map. Like, Spear are doing what BBZ need to be doing at this point in the game. And they're doing it so well.
They're really
snowballing this lead very effectively.
Coordination out of Team Spear has absolutely come online, and they have essentially shut down any chance BBZ has of coming back into this game. It is now a 10k gold lead almost. Only about a 5k
gold lead. I was about to say.
But still, my Dexia mixed in and I rearranged some numbers.
I feel you.
But still, this is going so poorly for Blue Bayou.
Mm-hmm. Now, BBZ, you know, they're in a really tough spot here. Lights, you know, he's doing fine. He's got around the same amount in terms of gold when it comes to, like, the item effectiveness overall. Nier down considerably. Dax, relatively the same. But in the 80 carry spot, that gold difference is massive. Red doesn't even have tier 2 boots finished. Leshy has tier 2 boots, Kraken Slayer, and Phantom Dancer, and they're already working on their next item.
Yeah, they've already got the components started for that. Leshy is just so far ahead in this game. He's like 5 or 6 minutes ahead. He's seeing the future at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And there's really nothing that Bayou can do against him because Pingu has not left his side, and that is one of the most devastating things that has been happening so far. Lights has got to get ooh, look at this is a nice Baron call. I like this Baron call.
Oh, they saw the ward there.
They did see the ward. I like Leshy's little sneaky deaky jump over the wall in order to showcase hey, I know you're there, no ward for you. All right, so they're basically going to set this up at this point, and we're just seeing Dax looking around, looking for an angle. I think they've basically just given up at this point. Varus looking for the blind arrow, doesn't manage to get it, and they're able to pick up that Baron pretty much for free.
Would have been cute. But, you know, Team Spear just going to rocket themselves into the lead here. They've already got a strong lead, but now with the Baron, they're going to be able to do so much more. I don't think BBZ can do anything about this.
Look at this. Big Brain did see Dax. He knew he was waiting in the side lane. That's going to be mid tower down. There's really nothing they can do. Orphic could essentially just tank this turret, and they could wipe out the entirety of BBZ before he's even all the way down to a quarter of his health. I really don't see any hope for Blue Bayou at this point.
Yeah. And Tristana's going to be doing so much damage to these towers. And the longer this game goes, the more attack range Tristana's going to get, and the more inaccessible she's going to be. They're going to opt to not take the inhibitor, which, honestly, at this point, I think that you do take the inhib. Like, early enough into the game, you shouldn't be, because it's just going to give them...
Look at that flash over the wall suppression. Big Brain Brian pulling Dax into the back line. Just gets him absolutely shredded. We have Varus trying to do the work, but he just does not have the items to do it. Flashes out, Lights going in for the backline, trying to get at that Tristana, isn't able to. Trist is basically just hidden now underneath that Cho'Gath, just running between his legs. We have look at that that was an interesting animation interaction right there. Diddle getting the kill on Varus. Sango trying to stay by the turret, but that turret's just going to fall. That's going to be top inhibitor down. Mid inhibitor is going to be available for free, but I have a feeling they're just going to straight push for the Nexus turrets.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was gonna say earlier, you know, taking the in him.
Orphic's very low right now.
He is low, but I don't think that BBZ can really do much about it.
They'd have to do a hard engage, basically, at this point. If Spear does not back off, they're gonna throw the game for themselves, but that's two inhibitors down. This is Team Spear's game to lose.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing I always like to say, no matter how far ahead or behind you are, it's still throwable. So, can Spear throw this hard enough? I don't know. They're definitely not looking to. They're definitely not looking to throw it. That's the thing. And there's so little counterplay available, especially because, you know, Red hasn't paid the Skarner attacks. Dax hasn't paid the Skarner attacks. Light hasn't paid the Skarner attacks. Nier and Songo technically have the Skarner attacks built into their kits, but either way, there's just not really going to be able to do that much.
There isn't, and unfortunately, once the Team Spear groups up as a five-man, there's nothing they can do. EBZ has to split push, but at this point, if you split push, you open yourself up to lose your last inhibitor.
Mm-hmm. And Orphic's on their way to a Gargoyle Stoneplate, and it's just going to be so, so difficult to get through that ridiculously huge amount of health.
There is so much tank that Cho'Gath probably is just like a Mundo where he's going to go where he pleases, and there's nothing BBZ can do about him. They don't have the damage to shred him quickly enough in order to get him gone, and they don't have the ability to jump in onto the back line to get Leshy, because Leshy's just going to basically run between his legs this whole fight.
Mm-hmm. All right, Nier's finished the shield bow, so we got 40% crit there.
It's not going to matter, though, as we just see the true damage coming out from Diddle to take down Sungo. We have Dax trying to go in, trying to get something to work. It's not going to matter. Light's going down on the back line, getting completely bursted down. Dax had to just go in and out. Orphic flashing, getting a nice knockup. Gangplank's getting in so low. We do have so much going out. That is just going to be a complete, absolute ace, as that is going to be game as Team Spear wipes out the Blue Bayou Zoo.
Oh my god. You know, Leshy has gotten so much done here, and Orphic in the front line have been so ridiculously difficult for BBZ to get past.
There's literally nothing that can be done for the side of BBZ. Skarner trying to get in, get the cheeky fountain, but not quite able to. Oh man, boy. That was a devastating game. Team Spear just took control of the reins and was like, oh, BBZ, we see what you want to do. How about no?
Mm-hmm. Now, BBZ, we have to give them some credit. They played the early really well. They had really good macro early. They played the early laning really well. But then that tower dive in mid, they committed so much to it, and Team Spear managed to punish that so hard, it ended up snowballing the state of the entire game.
It did. Like, that snowball was absolutely massive, and we did have Varus going on hit. I do think that's a little bit questionable with the GP in the game, because you have so much crit coming out from Gangplank right there. You kind of need the AP that's available from the Varus passive.
I mean, I would just say go straight up lethality at this point.
Yeah, you got to get through that shred as well. Like, you've got to shred through these tanks, because that Cho'Gath was becoming a monster.
It's more that with lethality, you're able to do damage while staying safe. And you have GP to keep them from getting to you. Either way, really good stuff from Team Spear to take down BBZ here.
Yeah, and that's why you're the color and I'm the shoutcaster. All right, with that, not much more to talk about this game. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back with an interview. Stick around.
Hello, folks. Chris Edgeworth here with Orphic from the victorious Team Spear. How you feeling?
Hey, man. I'm feeling fantastic right now.
That was a hell of a smacking to deliver to the commish and a team that is actually chomping at your heels a little bit as we get ready for playoffs. So let's talk a little bit about the draft that you guys pulled out in this game. If I'm remembering, you guys pulled out a blind Vel. Am I remembering that correctly? Blind Vel'Koz?
Yeah. We pulled out the blind Vel'Koz because BBZ made the mistake of not actually banning Diddle out this time because their coach is cocky as hell. He thinks that he can just give our mid laner his one trick and he thinks he can get away scot-free by picking a Kali. But everybody else needs to start banning the Vel'Koz again, unfortunately, because Diddle put in work.
I mean, I cannot see on the post game lobby, but I mean the horizon focus is so spicy. I love it, and I bet he got some serious work out of it. I heard them talking about that. I wasn't 100% sure that he was a Vel'Koz so-called one trick, more or less. I mean, the dude was absolutely scraping people. I love Cosby. Oh, I shouldn't say that on broadcast. Probably. I love Vel'Koz. Anyway, let's talk about the game. So you were playing with some serious pressure there in the early game. You're dealing with this GP matchup. You ended up turning it into the classic Orphic diff, especially with that spicy. Like, I saw the timer. I like panned down to look at what was going on bottom, and I saw your timer on your ult coming up, and I was like, if this guy tries something, he might actually like have the timer up by the time Dax shows up. And sure enough, this guy comes rolling in. I'm like, oh, does he have it? Oh, it's so good. So I loved it. I loved your play this game. Talk to me about what it was like getting with the early pressure and then, you know, turning it into the classic Orphic diff.
Yeah, I think that honestly, early game, I made my own blunders. I disrespected the early Udyr damage. But I think that I was playing top lane as aggressive as I could, trying to shove wave and reset. But, you know, they capitalized on me and got that early kill. But when it came down to it, you know, I think the play that really won that game was that play we made down in bot side jungle, which turned the game into a hard Orphic diff with my double kill or triple kill. And then we also got Leshy two kills after. And so since we added Leshy into our team, we no longer just have the Orphic diff. We also have the Leshy diff too, whereas I think that he is the strongest AD carry in this league. He just doesn't have the games and the numbers to really show that yet on any of the leaderboards. But, you know, the guy goes hard, and I feel really comfortable like picking a tank here, you know?
I respect that. You know, it's right before playoffs. You just bring in a ringer to just, you know, clean out the rest of the league. That's good. I like that. it's awesome that he has integrated so well with the team. And also, I want to do take a moment right now because we're talking about the Leshy Diff. Dude, my man Cheeky was cracked this game. He was just going all in with the flash alts all over the place. I love it.
Yo, hold on. I just, like, there was a play in mid lane right before we cracked the tier one that Cheeky got the nastiest Q on the Akali as the Akali went over the wall, and so it turned it into a double kill, and then we pushed. Cheeky was absolutely insane this game, honestly. Like, he went super hard, and I think that everybody this game really played together, and, you know, we had no lapse in comms. I was constantly talking about my R cooldown. Everybody was talking cooldowns. Everybody was talking objective timers, when we need to be there, when we can reset. Like, I don't know if this is our best performance yet, but I think this is a really strong showing going into playoffs. And, I mean, let's put it this way. If BBZ ends up losing this game, tomorrow's game, and then we win, we take their fourth seed spot, and then, you know, I think we get to play against Yumi, and Yumi should be afraid of us at this point.
I think everyone in the league should be afraid of you guys at this point, with the way that you guys are not just racking up wins, but racking up decisive wins. If you could you fill me in a little bit about what it's been like with the coaching staff aspect of this, especially as you guys are prepping to play some best of five series coming up?
We're taking some time to actually go in depth on some teams. Obviously, we'll be able to get more into specifics against teams once we actually see who we're up against when it comes to playoff time. And then, you know, we're just going to start grinding and adapting ourselves to how we need to adjust for certain teams. If we do go against UB, you know, they're extremely strong team, but INT really showed that they do have cracks, and you know, hopefully that I trash talked last time and said, you know, they have a weakness and we're gonna hit it, and we messed up and they outplayed us really hard, but I think that if we see them in a best of three, we're gonna go very hard against them.
All right, well, Orphic, thanks so much for joining me for this interview. Do you have any final words for us before we step away to game two?
I just want to say to BBZ's coach, Ben, you really need to stop trying to counterpick me, bro. It's not going to work, okay?
Quit trying to make counter matchups happen on red side. It's not going to happen. thanks so much for joining us for the interview. It's always a pleasure. You're very well spoken in these manners, so I really appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for having me again, Chris. I hope you have a good night.
You as well. Folks, don't go anywhere. We are going to be right back with a little bit of a show match for game two, so don't go away.
What makes you an exception?